Are you with me? Also, with the purity present. So the person goes, does wudu. What also do we have to get rid of? That the woman, if she says, I'm gonna do usul. And I'm gonna do wudu, can she pray? La, amani has to be absent. What's the amani? Hayd has to be absent. The hayd, her menstruation has to be also, she can't be there. So, the salah has shurut, and it has arkan, the shurut and the arkan, all of them have to be present. Now the word shart here, it encompasses the prerequisite, and it also encompasses the rukun here as well. And what else? وَانْتِفَاءِ مَوَانِعِهَا مَسْأَلَةُ التَّكْفِيرِ. The same. Shurut have to be present, all the shurut have to be there. And all of the mani' have to be absent. Jahal is a mani' and it's ilm is a shart. All of those matters, we have explained it in its place. So, la tatimmu al-ahkam, a hukum will not be established. Illa with what? Illa bi wujudi shurutiha, unless its conditions are present. Wa intifa'i mawani'iha, and the obstacle is absent. Absent. Inshallah ta'ala, this is a fa'idah. It's important that the student of knowledge learn this. Fa'idah. Fa'idah means what? The fa'idah is what? The fa'idah that I'm going to give you guys is what? Everybody, we took this before. And we touched it on this book when we were talking about it. But I didn't say at its place because I awaited it for here. What is it? Everybody who speaks, their statement, there's dalalatu mutabak and dalalatu tadammun. And a dalalatu iltizam. Everybody's statement. When I say a word, that speech of mine encompasses so many things. A lot of things you can bring it under when I speak. Taking part of that is called dalalatu tadammun. Dalalatul iltizam is what you can necessitate from my speech. You can necessitate it from my speech. Now let's take this for an example. Are you with me? The Asha'ira, what they do is they affirm, they negate characteristics which Allah has affirmed for Himself. Are you with me? They what? They negate characteristics that Allah affirmed for Himself. So what does that mean? From their statement, they're trying to say that, or so what it consists of their speech is that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, this characteristics isn't His. And also, what their speech consists of is that the ayah doesn't mean this. Those are the tadammur, what I take from their speech. That's what they said. And that's what they're going to admit to. Dalalatul iltizam, which is the third type. Which is what? Anyone who doesn't affirm the characteristics for Allah, he's made Allah what? Anyone who doesn't affirm a characteristic for Allah, then he is what? This is dalalatul iltizam. I'm necessitating this from their speech. That they are going against what? They are rejecting the statements of Allah. And then I can also necessitate from that they are also worshipping that which doesn't exist. Because how can something exist and not have any characteristics? So you guys are worshipping an idol, Adam, or something that doesn't exist. And then from that I can bring takfir on them. Ahlul Sunnah's tariqah isn't like, we can't do takfir on dalalatul iltizam. And this issue is called lawazimul qawl. Lazimul qawl, a statement which you brought out of, or you melted it out from the person's statement, لا يجوز تكفيره. You're not allowed to do takfir of him unless what? إلا أن يلتزم صاحبه. Unless the person admits to what that you necessitated from it. If he says, أخي, how? That's what I believe. But if you bring it out of his statement, you're not allowed to. And this is a manhaj Ahlul Sunnah have affirmed for the Khawarij. Ahlul Sunnah don't do this. For example, I can do the same to the person who drinks alcohol. I can say he's drinking alcohol because he sees it is halal. Why is he drinking it else for? That's lazimul madhab. You're necessitating it. He could be drinking it out of shahwa. Are you with me? Wahalumma jarra, and you can go on and on and on. This is la yajuz. You're not allowed to make takfir of a person. Walidalika, al-Shaykh AbdulRahman Nasir Sa'dee, he himself, he has a ta'liqat. I advise you all to go back to it. He has a ta'liqat. On what book? He has a ta'liqat on the kitab al-kafiyatu al-shafiyya lil-intisari li-firqati al-najah. It's matbu' mutadawal. Ibn al-Qayyim, when he speaks about it in his kafiyya, the nuniyya, Sheikh AbdulRahman Nasir Sa'dee, he explains it there very, mashallah, very good, very well. Also, Ibn Uthaymeen in his Qawa'id al-Muthla, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen in Qawa'id al-Muthla, he talks about it. And before all of them, Sheikh al-Islam al-Taymeen in his Majmu' al-Fatawa, he speaks about this issue, which is لازم المذهب. Ibn Uthaymeen has asked, rahimahullah ta'ala, a question regarding it, and yufassil. Sheikh details this issue. لازم المذهب is batil. To make a person mubtadi' based on what you melted from his statement. Or to make him a kafir based on what you melted from his statement. لا حتى يلتزم صاحبه. Unless the person takes it on board and says, أخي, what you're saying is what I meant. But if he says, أخي, subhanAllah, no, I don't believe all of that. That is لوازم. You're necessitating it for my speech. So it's important that that is understood very well. It goes back to this issue, لا تتم الأحكام إلا بوجود شروطها. وانتفاء موانعها. نعم.
وهذا أصل كبير بني عليه من مسائل الأحكام وغيرها شيء كثير.
وهذا أصل. This is a fundamental أصل. كبير, which is big. بني عليه. It was built upon it. من مسائل الأحكام. Issues of أحكام have been built on it. وغيرها and other than it شيء كثير. A lot of issues. كفر, صلاة, طاعة, زكاة, حج, all of them. You build on it. Build on what? وجود الشروط وانتفاء الموانع. Is the conditions met? Good. Is the obstacles absent? Good. Very good. Then and only then, تتم الحكم. The ruling can be established fully. نعم. So he's trying to say this أصل, this powerful قاعدة. A lot of مسائل have been built on it. نعم.
فمتى فقد شرط العبادة أو المعاملة
أو المعاملة
أو ثبوت الحقوق لم تصح ولم تثبت.
فمتى whenever فقد, it is absent, it's missing. What is missing? شرطون, a condition is missing. Over what? العبادة, a condition of عبادة. أو المعاملة, or a condition for a what? A transaction. So this person is not even pleased with selling this thing to you. Isn't rida, rida al-muta'aqidaini. The two people, the one that's selling this, buying it, both of them have to be pleased with what, sah? Because we talked about this, you know what? Al-buyu'u al-manhiyu anha shara'a. In our muhadara that we did. So, if the condition is missing, إذا فقد الشرط العبادة. The shart of the ibadah, for example, can be what? The tahara, for example, the for the salah. Or al mu'amala, I'm not even pleased to sell this product to you. You're forcing me. Or thubut al huquqi, or the presence of the condition of our person's rights. Yeah? The condition is not met. Then at this point, what do we say? At this point, we say that lam tasiha. This is it's not sahih. Wa lam tathbut, and it's not even affirmed. This is not affirmed on the person's rights, and this ibadah or this mu'amala is ghayra sahih, is fasid al-i'tibar. You haven't give back this person their property. You can't take it from them. Na'am.
Wa kadhalika idha wujida manu'iha lam tasihha wa lam tanfudh.
Wa kadhalika, the sheikh says also, idha wujida, if it's found, mani'uha, the obstacle that is standing between the ibadah or the mu'amala, if there's an obstacle there, لم تصح ولم تنفذ. You can't refer to this thing as sahih, and you can't also consider this what? That it's nafidh, that it took place. Meaning this bay' is not bay' which has taken any form. Or ibadah, it hasn't taken any result or effect has not come out of it. نعم.
وشروط العبادة والمعاملات كل ما تتوفق صحتها عليها ويعرف ذلك بالتتبع والاستقراء الشرعي.
وشروط العبادات, the conditions of عبادات, والمعاملات and transactions, كل, all of them, all of what? All of the conditions of عبادات and all of the conditions of معاملات, ما تتوقف صحتها, its correctness or it being correct, it stops at عليها ويعرف ذلك بالتتبع. For this ibadah or this mu'amala, for it to be correct, it's based on the condition. How do we identify the condition now? وَيُعْرَفُ the condition or the shart of this ibadah or the shart of this mu'amala is known by way of what? بِالتَّتَبُّعِ وَالِاسْتِقْرَاءِ الشَّرْعِ. تَتَبُّع means what? The ulama will follow up and they will follow up and they will follow up and they would realize that this is a condition. They will look at all the evidences and they will find that it falls under a shart. And تَتَبُّعُ الْاِسْتِقْرَاءِ tam, I spoke about it. أَمَا تَتَبُّعُ الْاِسْتِقْرَاءِ النَّاقِسِ. The two types of تَتَبُّع there is. تَتَبُّع is to follow up a matter and to say the final conclusion that I reach is what? Is this. For example, one of the تَتَبُّع that scholars they claim to, or somebody can claim to say is that every animal that eats, it loses the upper jaw. That when it bites, every creation, whenever they bite, they move the lower and the topper one is not moved, it's still. And the bottom part moves. And then, this is tatabbu', he said, I haven't seen anything else. After research, they found out that there is one that is opposite, different to this, which is the crocodile or the alligator. It puts its lower part on the earth and it just smacks the upper part on top of it. So, this is not called tatabbu' istiqra' tam. It's called tatabbu' istiqra' naqis. It's deficient. Are you with me? It's naqis, it's deficient. So it's that you follow up a matter and you say the result I reached is nothing leaves this. Who can do this? A muttali', a person who reads. And if you find out that isn't the case, then of course it becomes deficient. But tatabbu' and istiqra', it is something that is taken into consideration. We do take it into consideration. And that is what qawa'id al-fiqhi and its dawabid actually are based upon. Tatabbu' istiqra'. Naam.
Well, وبالأصل التتبعي حصر الفقهاء فرائض العبادة وشروطها وواجباتها.
وبأصل التتبعي and the original essence of following up حصر الفقهاء, the حصر is to make it exclusive or to narrow it down to a particular place. The فقهاء by the essence of تتبع, by following up, what they have is they've narrowed down or they've pinpointed the types of furud of fiqh ibadat is. So they'll say the salah, the furud of salah is this much. They've narrowed it down to an amount. They'll say 6, 7, 8, depending on which madhab it is. Or depending on whatever he saw it as, that mujtahid, that alim. So that, how do they get to that? How do they really know that the fara'id of salah, the wajibat of salah is this number? How? Tatabbu'. He followed up the evidences and he realized the definition of wajib is this, and all of these they fall under the definition. وَشُرُوطَهَا and its conditions. فَرَائِضَ الْعِبَادَاتِ وَشُرُوطَهَا and its conditions. وَوَاجِبَاتِهَا and its obligation. Naam. All of that came by what? By way of أَصْلُ التَّتَبُّعُ. Naam.
وَكَذَلِكَ شُرُوطُ الْمُعَامَلَاتِ وَمَوَانِعُهَا.
Also, shurut, the conditions of what? Al-mu'amalati. Wa mawani'iha. The conditions of what? The conditions of the mu'amalat. The scholars also found that by way of what? Bi asli tatabbu', by way of following up evidences. Wa mawani'iha, and the obstacles that prevent it, they also found that. So, shart, mani'. Wajib, arkan, all of them are found out by way of tatabbu'. And a tatabbu', can it be deficient? It can be naqis, and it can be tam. Like the nuhat, the grammarians, they said what? That the kalam is what? Three types. As Ibn Malik said, kalamuna lafdun mufidun kastaqim, wasmun wa fi'lun thumma harfun il kalim, wahidu kalimatun wal qawlu am, wa kilmatun biha, kalamu qad yu'am. Idan kalam, the kalima, the grammarians, they said, it doesn't need these three. تَتَبْعُ الْإِسْتِقْرَاتَ إِسْمٌ فِعْلٌ حَرْفٌ. It's تَتَبْعُ. They followed up. And when they looked at the speech that the Arabs speak, and everything which they have ever said, And whatever that's written in the books, they realize that it doesn't go out of one of these three. It doesn't leave ism, it doesn't leave a fi'l or a haf. It's one of these three. Naam.
والحصر إثبات الحكم في المذكور ونفيه عما عداه.
Now the sheikh is telling you, so he told you تتبع, now he's telling you a matter known as حصر. What does حصر mean? And what's the explanation of حصر? حصر means إثبات الحكم في المذكور ونفيه عما عداه. It is to affirm the ruling in the aforementioned thing. Whatever was mentioned, affirming a ruling for it and negating it from everything other than it. It's called exclusivity, right? It's anything which you say exclusively. You're the only one who has this. You're affirming it only for a particular thing and you're negating it from everything else. This is called what? So Hassan here is trying to, the reason why he brought Hassan is because when it came to the shurut, when it came to the mawani', when it came to the fara'id or the wajibat, and when it came to the arkan and the sunan, all of that came by way of what? By way of tatabbu'. But there has to be a form of hasr in it. Because they're going to say that the wajibat for the salah are only six. Mathalan, or seven. So they've only affirmed seven, and they've negated the rest. This is called hasr. And the shurut is the same. And that, so this is important that the talib ilm learns this. When a other madhab adds another one to it, this is not called khilafu tanawu', it's called khilafu tabad. Because this guy is negating and this one is affirming. Because you know what hasr means, right? Na'am. So when one goes, the conditions of the salah are seven, for example, and the other one comes and says eight. The one that says seven has only he's done hasr on these seven only, and he said that it can't be anything else. This one who added an eighth one has to go against this one, and this is called ikhtilafu tabad. Their differences is opposition. It's not a differences in wordings that you can bring them together. No, wadih? Is it crystal clear? Because the aslu tatabbu'i is what? حصر الفقهاء فرائض العبادات وشروطها وواجباتها وموانعها is حصر, which is إثبات الحكم في المذكور ونفي عما عداه. نعم.
فيستفاد من حصر الفقهاء شروط الأشياء وأمورها أن ما عداها لا يثبت له الحكم المذكور.
What do we benefit from حصر? What benefit does it give us? As I explained, فَيُسْتَفَادُ مِنْ حَصْرِ الْفُقَهَا. When the fuqaha do a hasr on a matter, and they only mention it. So that's why I sometimes say to you, this is عَلَى سَبِيلِ التَّمْثِيلِ لَلْحَصْرِ. I'm only just giving you guys an example, but this is not only this. Because I don't want you to think that I'm only affirming the ruling for this. Are you with me? Huh? I want to show that there are more. I'm only mentioning a couple of them. Like in when the fuqaha do a matter like this, they mean it as ala sabil al hasr. And what do we benefit from it? What we benefit from it is what? That anna ma adaw, anything other than that which they have mentioned, they've negated it. La yathbutu lahu al-hukm. The ruling cannot be given to it. They've negated the rest. They only want it for this. So according to this imam who said that the shurut is seven, and the other one who said eight, he's only given the ruling of shurut to the seven. And he has negated else others. This one, on the other hand, has affirmed it for eight, and he's negated another. He's negated anything else. That is the benefit that we take from hasr. Also, what we benefit from hasr as well is that, and it's also the sheikh what he said, is that, for example, when the ways that hasr occurs, the way that it occurs, is anything that deserves to be delayed. If it gets put forward, it benefits hasr. Are you with me? Anything that deserves to be placed late, if it's put forward, it should have been a bit behind. If it gets put forward in the sentence, it gives us the word meaning hasr. For example, which one comes first? The fa'il and the fi'il or the maf'ul bih? The fi'il and the fa'il go before the what? Maf'ulun bih. What about if I take the maf'ulu bi and I put the maf'ulu bi at the beginning? So in Arabic language, the sentence is like this, not like English. In Arabic, this is the sentence. This is the right order. If you change the order, hasr comes from it. Verb, subject, and the object. How about if I take the object, which is the last one, and I put it at the beginning? Hasr comes out of it. That meaning, for example, Allaha as'alu. It was meant to be what? As'alullaha. I ask Allah. So the verb comes first. As'alu is a fi'il. Where's the fa'il? Is dhamir, mustatir. Which is what? And I ask Allah what? So as'alullaha. I ask Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. I ask Allah. Pay attention to this now. If I put Allah before the subverb and the subject, what does it benefit us? Exclusivity. Meaning, if I was to say as'alullah, it means I ask Allah and I also ask other than Allah. But when I say Allah as'alu, it means I don't ask anybody, only Allah. So this asking is exclusively to Allah. When I put the maf'ulu bi first, hasr comes out of it. Do you see? But if I just kept the sequence the normal way it is, then it would have just been, I ask Allah. It doesn't negate that I don't ask others. Are you with me? That is, it's called تقديم ما حقه التأخير يفيد الحصر. Another thing that benefits us and hasr is what? If a negation and then an affirmation, which hasr stands on anyways. Like if you say nafyun and then you use ithbat. Which is, for example, La ilaha illallahu. This ibadah, worship, who have you exclusively affirmed it for? Allah. Are you with me? You've affirmed it because what did you do? You negated it from everybody else. And you've given it only to who? Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And then that's the pillar that La ilaha illallah stands on. Nafyun wa ithbatun. Hasr is nafy and ithbat. You are not allowed to give ibadah to anybody other than Allah. And then this is what the scholars mean by when they say hasr. And it's very beneficial that you learn hasr because the way you speak, the way you articulate your words, and also when the ulama pass a ruling, you'll understand, is it hasr, is it ala sabili tamthil, and what not. It will benefit you a lot. Naam.
وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ قَوْلُهُمْ الْحُكْمُ يَدُورُ مَعَ إِلَّةِ ثُبُوتٍ وَعَدَمًا.
And now the sheikh is going to go to in another issue, which is, الْحُكْمُ, a ruling, يَدُورُ, it revolves around, مَعَ إِلَّتِهِ, its reason. Thubutan, whether it's present, wa adaman, and when it's absent. What does this mean? What was the reason why alcohol was made prohibited? The reason why alcohol was made haram is iskar, intoxicates the mind. If the iskar is absent, does the ruling go? So what was the ruling why alcohol was made haram? So the ruling on alcohol is what? First of all, the question is what's the rule in alcohol? Hurma, it's haram. Are you with me? Alcohol is what? Alcohol is haram. And then the question that arises is that, why is alcohol haram? Because you're going to have to tell me the illa. The illa why alcohol is haram is because of what? Iskar. It intoxicates the mind. Good. Now, the hukum always revolves around the illa, the reason. Wujudan, whether the reason is present. Wa adaman, and whether it's present. I mean, if it's present, it takes one ruling. If it's absent, it takes another ruling. That's what this qa'idah is. Now, let's get rid of the reason, which is intoxication. Does the ruling change with it? What does the ruling become? Permissibility. If I bring back the reasoning of intoxication, what happens to the ruling? The harim comes. So the hukum, a ruling always revolves around that reason. It's present or it's absent. You have to observe it. If it's present, you give it the ruling that it deserves. And if it's absent, you give it the ruling that it deserves. So, al-hukmu yaduru ma'ilati wujudan wa adama. Ama thubutan wa adama. Wujudan, some say, and some say thubutan wa adama. Now, this is one thing I want you to all understand. Are you with me? The illah, the reason. The illah is two types. Illah which is mansusa. A illah where we find the reasoning through text. The illah, the reason, sometimes we find it by way of text. Are you guys with me? Like the fact that alcohol, the illah why it was made haram, the Prophet told us. Because he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, kullu ma askara. Or the Prophet said in the hadith, huh? The Prophet he said in the hadith, alayhi salatu wasalam, kullu ma askara qalilu fa kathiru haram. In another hadith, the Prophet said, that kullu muskirin haram. Everything that intoxicates is haram. So the reasoning why alcohol was made haram is based on this hadith. The illah is mansus. I have evidence for this illah. Are you with me? The second type is called illah mustambata. It's not mansus. Ghayra mansus. There's no text for it. The scholars are going to do istimbat. They're going to go out their way and they're going to extract a reasoning for it. And they differ on it. Based on their differing on the illah, the hukum changes, right? And there comes out khilaf amongst the fuqaha on the issue of illah and whatnot. And I talked about that also in our kitab al-qawa'id al-fiqhiyya, the sheikh AbdulRahman Nasir Sa'dee, rahimahullahu ta'ala. Na'am.
فالعلل التامة التي يعلم أن الشارع رتب عليها الأحكام متى وجدت وجد الحكم ومتى فقدت لم يثبت الحكم.
The sheikh said, whenever فالعلل التامة, the reasonings which are complete, التي يعلم, which based on it we will know أن الشارع, that the legislator رتب عليها الأحكام, he based ruling on this illah. We find out, we know. متى وجد, whenever وجدت, whenever it's found, وجد الحكم, the ruling will be found. ومتى فقدت, and whenever it's not found, لم يثبت الحكم, the ruling will not also be found. And it's, as I said before, that so the illah is always revolving around the ruling. So for you to know what the hukum is, try to look for the illah, the reasoning. Whenever the reasoning is present, then of course the ruling differs from when the reasoning is absent. And how to know the illah is a whole different road, and it needs a lot of explanation, which we won't go into right now. Naam.
وَمِنْ ذَلِكَ قَوْلُهُمْ الْأَصْلُ فِي الْعِبَادَاتِ الْحَضْرُ إِلَّا مَا وَرَدَ عَنِ الشَّارِعِ تَشْرِيعُ والأصل في العادات الإباحة إلا ما ورد عن الشارع تحريمه.
Now the sheikh is going to go into a matter which is very, very important and people need to know it very much, which is the issue of عبادات. What's the أصل for it? What's the أصل of عبادات? الأصل في العبادات, the أصل, the original essence of عبادات is what? الحظر, prohibition. Ibadat is that it's prohibited for you to do anything whatsoever. You're not allowed to. إِلَّا مَا وَرَدَ عَنِ الشَّارِعِ تَشْرِيعُ. Except that which the Sharia has legislated. Anything that the Sharia has legislated, you are allowed to do. But if there isn't no legislation in this matter, we stick to the original essence, we stick to the istishab. بقاء ما كان على ما كان, that it's haram. Where is the evidence for this? The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said in the hadith, من عمل عملا ليس عليه أمرنا فورد. Anyone who does a matter that is not from our affairs, it's rejected. The hadith of Aisha رضي الله تعالى عنها in صحيح البخاري المسلم. The other wording which is من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فورد. And if you take these two wordings of the hadith, it gives you a good understanding of this important matter that we're talking about, which is, somebody may say to you, أخي, I am not the one. من أحدث في أمرنا هذا ما ليس منه فورد. Somebody may say to you, I am not the one who introduced this innovation. Because the hadith says, anyone who introduces a matter into the religion, and it's not from our affairs, then it's rejected. He may say to you, أخي, I never introduced it. It was done way before me. The other hadith is what we're going to bring him. Which is what? من عمل, anyone who does an action. من عمل عملا, anyone who does an action, ليس عليه أمرنا, and our affairs is not built on it. And we haven't done this. فَوَرَدٌ, it is rejected. Now I want you to ponder this with me, because there are a group of people who, based on their ignorance and lack of understanding of the Arabic language, thought there is a lead way or a way out of this, which is that the Prophet ﷺ explicitly in this hadith, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَوَرَدٌ. Man here is what? Man, it shows umum. It's from adawat al-umum. We took them. Ma and man are umum. And there's another generalization in the sentence, which is what? Amalan. Man amila amalan laysa alayhi amruna fahuwa raddun. Shows generalization. That whoever comes with a matter that we haven't done, then it's rejected. It's not accepted from you. And it backs up the other hadith, and the other hadith backs it up. They both back each other up. When the Prophet ﷺ said, "Kullu bid'atin dalala," every innovation is misguidance. وَكُلُّ ضَلَالَةٍ فِي النَّارِ. You see? So, whatever matter you bring to the religion, it's rejected. And you always have to remind yourself the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, where he said, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّتِي, upon you is my sunnah. Follow my sunnah. Why do you want more? The person should not go outside the borders of that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came with. عليكم بسنتي وسنة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين عضوا عليها بالنواجد. Hold on to that. وإياكم. Then the Prophet told you there's another path other than his sunnah or the sunnah of his rightly guided khulafa. There's another path. What path is that? It is the path of anyone who introduces something. He brings it into the religion. He introduces it into the religion. وَإِيَّاكُمْ وَمُحْدَثَاتِ الْأُمُورِ. Stay away from the newly invented matters. Stay away from that. Anyone who introduces a matter into the religion, or anybody who does something that is introduced into the religion, he's saying one of two statements. That's what he's saying, whether he agrees or not. The first one is what? He's saying that the messenger did not convey the religion to us, and that he deceived us in not conveying the religion. And me doing this bid'ah and this innovation, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew this and he chose not to convey this to me or to convey it to us. Or if he's not saying that, then he's saying the other one, which is he's saying that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not know this, was unaware of this good that I am aware of, huh? And both of them are as evil as one another. Because the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he, the ninth of Hijriyah, sorry, it was on the ninth of the day of Arafah, on a Friday, our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam climbed the pulpit, Arafah, the Mount of Arafah, Jabal al-Rahma as they call it now. The Prophet mounted on that mountain, he climbed the mountain and he looked at the people and he read the ayah that came down on him. It was on a Friday. The Prophet ﷺ is Arafah. And he said to them, Al-yawma akmaltu lakum deenakum, wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati, wa raditu lakum al-Islam deena. Today your religion has been complete. Complete. And it's, Allah is saying, Al-yawma today, akmaltu lakum deenakum, I have completed your religion for you. Akmaltu lakum deenakum. وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي, and I have completed my blessing unto you. وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا, and I have become Islam as your religion, which I am pleased with. I mean, Allah was pleased with something, which was that thing he sent to the Prophet. This is what I'm pleased with. So anything outside that day, what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam legislated, what's outside, Allah is not pleased with it. Imam Malik said something. He said, فَمَا لَمْ يَكُنْ يَوْمَئِذٍ دِينًا فَلَا يَكُونُ الْيَوْمَ دِينًا. Whatever wasn't a religion that day will not be a religion today. What wasn't a religion that day, whatever wasn't a religion that day is not going to be a religion today. Who quoted that from Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala? His great student, Abdul Aziz ibn Majishun. And Imam Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi, he brought it in his Kitab al-Ihtisam. So, based on that, the person should stay away from innovation. He should not introduce anything into this religion. And he should follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وما نهاكم عنه فانتهوا. Whatever the Prophet ﷺ brought to you and gave to you, take it from him. Whatever he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited, stay away from. فليحذر الذين يخالفون عن أمره أن تصيبهم فتنة أو يصيبهم عذاب أليم. They should be very cautious and very scared and worried, the one who opposes the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's affairs. عن أمره, his affairs is everything. عن أمره here means what he said, what he did, and also what he left. It falls under عن أمره. Amar is general. So whatever he left is from his affairs. Stay away from opposing him in that as well. Don't oppose him by doing something he hasn't done. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the asal of the ibadat is what? It is hadr, prohibition. And the evidence is the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. وعن أبيها. May Allah also be pleased with her father. So what do we need for this evidence? We need Allah tabarak wa ta'ala to legislate for us. No one else is allowed to legislate. Every innovator is a legislator. Everyone who innovates, he's legislating. As Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said in the Quran, أَمْ لَهُمْ شُرَكَاءَ شَرَعُوا لَهُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ مَا لَمْ يَأْذَنْ بِهِ اللَّهِ. And they fall under the ayah, Surah Ash-Shura, ayah 21. They are what? They are legislating. They are setting rules which our Messenger ﷺ did. Anyone who celebrates Miladun Nabi, or anybody who does any other thing that are added to the religion, they're introducing. لذلك Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, he said, اتبعوا ولا تبتدعوا فقد كفيتم. Follow, do not innovate, for verily you have been sufficed. That job has been done for you. Just follow, don't introduce anything. And the ulama of the sunnah mention, and they say, that every single time a people introduce a innovation, a sunnah dies. And look at this. If you look at it, you realize. When the people turn away from the sunnah, and they leave off that which has been legislated by Allah, shaitan gets rid of that, and he brings something else, and the people start doing the newly introduced matter. So based on that, and if anybody says to you, if anybody sends you a evidence to bring that we can't celebrate the Prophet's birthday, this person, you can see from this straight away that he is an ignorant individual. Anyone who tells you to bring him an evidence that he can't celebrate the Prophet's birthday, he's asking you to bring him قال الله قال الرسول. So you can't celebrate the Prophet's birthday. Then that person, he doesn't know the bidayat, the beginning of this book is. This book that we're reading right now, at the top, it says what? Al-madkhal ila usul al-fiqh. It's just an introduction to usul al-fiqh. And it's not even considered from the books that you can say to yourself, I have studied usul al-fiqh very well. When the scholars, they count, they start from al-waraqat and onwards. And it's in this small little book, which is al-asl. I'm not the one who has to bring it. I'm upon the istishab, I'm upon the asl, sahib. I'm upon the asl. You as an individual have to bring me evidence to do this. My Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah, they legislate things for me. They tell me what to do, what I can't do. You have to bring me an evidence for me that I can do this. Naam.